Hi, welcome back to our series on calibration. I'm Bob Stern, a senior metrologist from Agilent Technologies. I'd like to welcome you to this module on Z540.3 compliance. In this module, we're going to be referring to the Z540.3 standard, and also I'll be referencing some of the compliance techniques that are available, or recommended techniques that are available through the Z540.3 handbook. So this is module 7 in our series, Z540.3 compliance. If you recall a little bit earlier on, we were talking about, so which standards does your company want to comply to? If you're doing any work today that requires you to do Z540-1, there's a very good chance that in the not too distant future, you may very well have a contract which calls for Z540.3. You saw in one of our earlier modules, we were talking about why calibrate and the third alternative, especially in aerospace defense applications. This is the one, number 3, which is really calling in Z540.3. Now, before I dive straight into Z540.3, I want to just show you how this positions with all of the standards that we're trying to meet, we or any other calibration provider. So let's just take a look as you look at standards from around the world. Remember 17025, there was that critical statement, when statements of compliance are made, the uncertainty shall be taken into account. And one of the key documents for guidance of that was the ILAC G8. And we looked at that in depth in module 5. We're not really talking about it too much in this series, but for voltmeters, there's actually a specific standard that we look at as well. So now on to the topic at hand, Z540.3. Now, the standard itself is only 10 pages, but there's a single paragraph that almost swamps everything else in terms of its importance, and that's the one there that you see in green. We're going to drill in a little bit and try to understand that one better. So back to our diagram one more time. Now what we're going to do is go straight to that situation where you have a test point that is measuring in spec, but it's very close to the border. And so let's just look at that paragraph, where calibrations provide for verification that measurement quantities are within specified tolerances. That's standard speak for is it in spec. The probability that incorrect acceptance decisions will result from calibration shall not exceed 2%. Let me draw that on the diagram for you. We put in our measurement uncertainty. What they're saying is the amount of that red zone, if you integrate over that probability, cannot exceed 2%. There are methods out there where you can calculate the probability of false acceptance by looking at the probability density function and doing a double integral over the region of interest. Now, I don't know about you, but here's where I come out on this. Panic. When I first read this standard on behalf of Agilent, I had no idea how we were going to meet it. But several years later, it's much better, because now you have the Z540.3 handbook, and I in particular recommend to you Appendix A. The rest of the handbook is very good, but if you're new to it, I would go straight to Appendix A and start reading right there. The handbook that I was holding up earlier on has an excellent tutorial on the probability of false acceptance. It has the details on how to implement 6 alternative compliance methods, any one of which can be used to comply. And since these were published, there's even other papers out there. There's even a Method 7 that people are working on. But nevertheless, the handbook gives you 6 choices for how you can comply to the standard. And as I said earlier on, it's available from the NCLSI online store. And what you want to do is look for the area that says documentary standards, and you can find it there. Now, if you read the handbook, what you'd find is if you looked at a summary of all of the 6 recommended methods, there's 2 important points that I guess I'd like to make. The information that it takes to pass the 2% probability of false acceptance varies with each method. One thing to notice, over on the right-hand side there, you'll see that all 6 methods make use of the ISO guide for expression of uncertainty of measurement. This is that chart that we were showing you earlier on. All the latest standards reference the ISO guide for expression of uncertainty of measurement. And at Agilent, the 2 methods that we like to use for meeting Z540.3 is either Method 5 or Method 6. Now, oftentimes, I make a statement here, and people who are familiar with ILAC G8, this strikes them as they never thought about it this way. Just to be clear, when we were talking about ILAC G8 before and using the expanded uncertainty as a guard band, that is what you need to have a clean pass using ILAC G8. And it turns out that is identical to Z540.3 method 5. So if you look earlier on at the choices that you can get in the Americas, Agilent Cal plus uncertainties plus guard banding meets Z540.3 using method 5. And because we have been developing measurement uncertainty since 1996, Agilent is in a position to offer Z540.3 Cal for more than 700 instruments. Here's a sample calibration certificate, and the main thing I want to show you is if you had ordered Agilent Cal plus uncertainties plus guard banding, you would get a certificate like this that says it's compliant both with Z540.3 and 17025. And one other note on accreditation, you remember we said that you can be accredited for 17025 or separately, and here is the cover certificate for our Roseville, California Service Center. Notice, obviously, 17025 and also both of the Z540 standards as well. Now, if you're one of the folks who has your own calibration lab and likes to self-maintain, then the N7800 calibration and adjustment software platform is something that you may already be using or might want to consider. So for over 170 instruments, we make available our service software under license. And so if you happen to be using the N7800 software, then when you select the 17025 mode, you also are meeting Z540.3 using method 5. So really, in summary, it's pretty simple. If you're buying your instruments from Agilent Technologies and you either send those instruments to us for calibration or you're doing it yourself with our N7800 Cal software platform, then you comply with Z540.3. What we're really trying to do is Agilent wants to make sure that compliance to Z540.3 at your company is a non-event for our instruments. If you'd like to get a little bit more information on Z540.3, we have some very nice links and some literature, and you can click on this button here to go look at it, or you can see the URL to go find it on the web. Finally, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank you for listening to these modules on calibration. It's certainly been our pleasure to cover many of these important topics. We hope this was useful to you. If you have further questions, please feel free to contact your support field engineer or any of us in the Agilent support organization. We'll try to answer your questions, and who knows, they may even ask me. Thank you very much.